Participants and respected panelists, especially today's speaker, Professor Dr. M.D. Mamun Rashid sir, is the professor of NICBD, also a dynamic treasurer of Bangladesh Cardiac Society. Sir, welcome you in our IPDA virtual classroom. We are really honored, delighted in this important session you give enough time to us. Professor Bahadur sir, please comment on this class.
Assalamu alaikum. I hope everybody is quite well. Today in our IPDA lecture series, we'll be talking about cardiomyopathy. It's a very interesting and heterogeneous disorder of different presentation, different varieties. And Professor Mamunur Rashid, our Sijar Bhai, will be talking about that. Without much ado, let's enjoy his lecture. Professor Dr. Muhammad Mamunur Rashid.
শুরু করতে বলছো তো আসসালামু আলাইকুম এন্ড গুড আফটারনুন মহসিন শুনতে পাচ্ছ আমাকে
হ্যাঁ শুনতে পাচ্ছি আমি
আমি
সবাইকে মিউট করে দিচ্ছি আপনি শুধু আনমিউট আছেন
আচ্ছা ওকে ফার্স্ট অফ অল আই লাইক টু থ্যাংকস এন্ড কনগ্রাচুলেট দ্য IPDA organization, especially the Professor Abdul Wadud Chaudhary and Dr. Mohsin Ahmed for arranging a brilliant and innovative lecture sessions in the webinar. And I am highly delighted and honored to be a part of this session. Today's my topic is cardiomyopathy. In our student life and as well as still now there is a lot of debate regarding the etiology and classification of the cardiomyopathy. I will try to present it as simple as my possibility, and everyone can share his view, which is encouraged. Now the cardiomyopathy. Already Professor Wadud said that cardiomyopathy is a heterogeneous group of disease of the myocardium. Cardiomyopathy is a heterogeneous group of disease of the myocardium, which makes it harder for heart to pump to the rest of the body. It is associated with the mechanical and electrical dysfunction, which usually exhibits inappropriate ventricular hypertrophy or dilatation due to a variety of etiologies that frequently are genetic. Cardiomyopathies are either confined to the heart or part of a generalized systemic disorder, both often leading to the cardiovascular death and progressive heart failure related disability. There are several classification. I will show here the three classification. There is who classified the simple way, that is primary and secondary. It is the dilated, hypertrophic, restricted, and the secondary ones. It is published in the 1980. And in ESC classification, here the I think there's a little bit complicated. There is cardiomyopathies. They also classify it as in the broad heading, that is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, dilated arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, and restrictive cardiomyopathy. All of our and again divided into familial and non-familial, and then genetic defects. I like that the this classification. I think that it is more simpler. That is primary and secondary cardiomyopathies. Again, primary cardiopathy is divided. I'll show that in the later on slide. The genetics mixed and acquired. That is American Heart Association or American College of Cardiology. This classification. There is primary and intrinsic cardiomyopathy, which predominantly involves the heart. It's a genetic portion, that is the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, LV non-compaction, ion channelopathies, mitochondrial myopathies, and glycogen stress. And there is acquired cause, there is inflammatory myocarditis by inflammatory cardiomyopathy, ischemic cardiomyopathy, stress cardiomyopathy, peripartum or postpartum cardiomyopathy, tachycardia. And there is a mixed variety. There's all often we are know that is the dilated cardiomyopathy. It is a mixed variety having some genetic component and the acquired component. And then the another is the restrictive cardiomyopathy. We'll discuss later on. And secondary cardiomyopathy, there is a, which are the result of the illness affecting other parts of the body. There is a metabolic and storage disease. Fabry's, lots of names there, Fabry's disease, hemochromatosis, endomyocardial fibrosis, hyperautonomic syndrome, and the systemic disease like endocrine. There is a diabetes mellitus, hyperthyroidism, acromegaly. Autoimmune disease, it's contributing a major sharing. There is nowadays, there is systemic sclerosis, rheumatoid arthritis, systemic lupus erythematosus, and cirrhotic cardiomyopathy, alcohol cardiomyopathy. And there is some drugs which are not mentioned here, that is cocaine or amphetamine, and some anti-cancer drug are also contributed to the dilated cardiomyopathy. Neuromuscular causes, then muscular dystrophy and Friedreich's ataxia, all are the secondary causes. Now I am coming to the, that is the, I today, the, though cardiomyopathy is a vast chapter, I will discuss the dilated cardiomyopathy in broad heading, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and restrictive cardiomyopathy, and arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. The dilated cardiomyopathy is a condition in which the heart becomes dilated and cannot pump blood effectively. This is the fundamental thing, and characterized by the myocyte damage, reduced systolic function, multiple etiology, and similar resultant pathophysiology. It means that it also has the primary etiology and secondary etiology, but resultant pathophysiology is the same in the set, all cases. I will discuss dilated cardiomyopathy etiologically in some shortly, and then the as a whole, that is diagnosis, treatment, transfusion as a whole comprehensively I will discuss. Here is the pathological feature of the dilated cardiomyopathy, that is the four ventricles, both ventricles and atria, that is four chambers are dilated, but in case of ischemic cardiomyopathy, the already the regional, that is segmental portion dilated, that is LVR dilated. Here it is the dilated cardiomyopathy, and there is a scarring of the mitral and tricuspid lesions due to the interstitial fibrosis and secondary dilatation of the annuli, and most of all the reduced systolic function. Now come to the causes of the dilated. During the classification, I already said the dilated cardiomyopathy in the mixed variety. That is, it has the familial or genetic component and also the secondary causes. That is, familial or idiopathic dilated cardiomyopathy comprises the around 60% of the dilated cardiomyopathy. This familial and cardiomyopathy majority is the genetic origin. And most familial dilated cardiomyopathy are autosomal dominant, and there is some autosomal recessive and X-linked recessive and matrilineal inheritance also. And basic genetics problem, there is a mutation in the genes encoding the dystrophin and cyclo sacroglycan and troponin I and mitochondrial. Non-genetic cause of the DCN, that means secondary cause, that is the coronary heart disease and high blood pressure, diabetes mellitus, thyroid disease, myocarditis, it also plays a major role in the developing the dilated cardiomyopathy, especially the viral infection, one of we are all facing, that is called COVID-19 virus. And heart valve disease, that is valvular cardiomyopathy, autoimmune mediated, already I mentioned, that is systemic, especially alcoholic cardiomyopathy, all are, I mentioned, drugs and other postpartum or peripartum cardiomyopathy, which usually occurs the last month of the pregnancy or within the 5 months of the after the birth. And other causes, non-genetic causes, there's cirrhotic cardiomyopathy, tachycardia-induced cardiomyopathy, premature ventricular contraction-induced cardiomyopathy, and Takotsubo cardiomyopathy, stress cardio or broken heart. It is also now is in focus due to the viral infection, that is COVID-19 also. And last three are the reversible dilated cardiomyopathy. This can be reversed if the treatment is started, and the postpartum cardiomyopathy also reverse. Pathophysiology, that is, I already said that the pathophysiology is complex. There is the mutation of the genome and the exogenous insult, that is secondary causes. Both plays a role to develop the pathophysiological chance, that is contraction and hyperreactivation, disorder of the myocardium, ineffective energy utilization, altered calcium ions handling. And these are compensatory mechanism, neurohormonal mechanism is coming, and apoptosis, fibrosis, hypertrophy, these are all the pathophysiological features. And this all ultimately leads to the heart failure, arrhythmia, sudden death, and thromboembolic complication. Here I just read the pathophysiology of the dilated cardiomyopathy is better understand at the cellular level with advance in molecular techniques. Mutant proteins already mentioned that can disturb the cardiac function in the contractile apparatus, cardiomyocyte alteration, and their persistent response at the cellular level causes changes that are correlated with the arrhythmia, sudden cardiac death, heart failure, thromboembolic complication. This is the main pathology and pathogenesis, all leads to the cardiac failure and arrhythmia, and these are leads to the thromboembolic manifestation and cardiac death. Now I describe the type of dilated cardiomyopathy, just a short, that is familial or idiopathic dilated. Already I mentioned that it comprises the 60% of the dilated cardiomyopathy. Majority is genetic only. I already said that autosomal dominant is the majority, and minority is the autosomal recessive recessive. Diagnosis can be the three generation family history is essential for diagnosis by history, and screening of the family member and genetic testing can be done. Mutation in genes encoding dystrophin, sarcoglycan, troponin, already I mentioned. Peripartum or postpartum cardiomyopathy, it is a one kind of type of dilated cardiomyopathy. Also, is a common, uncommon form of heart failure that happens during the last month of pregnancy or up to 5 months after giving birth. Usually detected by echocardiography and history symptom and like heart failure. In echocardiography, ejection fraction was less than 40% usually, and epidemiology in 1 in 4,000 women. Proposed mechanism, there is the inflammatory cytokines and some genetic predisposition also there. The prognosis, full recovery occurs in the, that is achieving of the ejection fraction more than 55% at 12 month postpartum is around 75% is a trial. Average it is around 50 to 80%. So one trial in Germany shows then around 85%. That means the prognosis is good with adequate treatment and started in the proper time. Autoimmune and immune-mediated cardiomyopathy, that is autoimmune diseases like systemic sclerosis, rheumatoid arthritis, SLE, these are causing dilated cardiomyopathy. This causes the involvement of the epicardial intramural coronary artery, causing the ischemic heart disease, valve disease, there is several regurgitation lesion, conducting defects, arrhythmia, pericarditis, myocardial damage, causing prodding, low-grade inflammation and fibrosis, or only isolated fibrosis, leading to the common pathophysiological change, that means heart failure or sudden cardiac death or thromboembolic complication. The autoimmune diseases that commonly causes cardiomyopathy having DCM-like phenotype. It's also the genetic predisposition have. Iatrogenic cardiomyopathy can result from common medications. There is some drug, there is autoimmune disease which is treating, like hydroxychloroquine also causes either restrictive or dilated cardiomyopathy. And in the anti-cancerous rheumatoid, the TNF-alpha inhibitors also leading to the dilated cardiomyopathy. Alcoholic cardiomyopathy, if the chronic users of alcoholic may develop the dilated cardiomyopathy, reversible with abstinence. Continuous use is associated with 3 to 6 years mortality exceeding 50%. Direct toxic effects, that is pathology, is that the direct toxicity of alcohol on heart muscle, that is mitochondrial oxidative phosphorylation, fatty acid oxidation, myocyte cell death, and fibrosis. All this leads to the myocardial cell damage and the dilatation of the heart and ultimately heart failure. Myocarditis or inflammatory cardiomyopathy, inflammation of the heart muscles. It is symptoms here is especially there should be chest pain and the irregular heartbeats and decreased ability to exercise. Duration hours to months, it may develop so rapidly. Now the COVID-19 is sometimes it developed acute heart failure. Causes, there is viral infection already mentioned, bacterial infection, certain medications, toxin, and auto disorder. Complication, heart failure due to the dilated cardiomyopathy, cardiac arrest. Diagnosis, ECG, troponin I, echocardiography, cardiac MRI, heart biopsy. Treatment other than conservative treatment, other than there is heart failure treatment. Here the role of the corticosteroids and intravenous immunoglobulin may be useful in certain cases. Stress cardiomyopathy, one case is reported in the some cases in the USA. There is acute but rapidly reversible LV systolic dysfunction in the absence of atherosclerosis coronary artery disease. These are triggered usually by the profound psychological stress, that is now a corona pandemic, there is a lot of psychological stress, and usually the older women here the preferentially involves the apical distal portion of the LV chamber, that's why it is also called the apical balloon also. Although presentation often mimics with the ST segment elevation myocardial infarction, outcome is favorable with appropriate medical therapy. Ischemic cardiomyopathy. Previously, it was separated. Now, it is incorporated in the cardiomyopathy, that is dilated cardiomyopathy. Ischemic cardiomyopathy is a type of dilated cardiomyopathy caused by the narrowing of the coronary arteries which supply to the heart. Prior history of previous extensive myocardial infarction and severe coronary artery. Cardiomyopathy causes around 60 to 70% cases of the systemic congestive heart failure in most countries in the world. Pathophysiology, that is reduced oxygen supply due to the poor LV systolic function, reaching to the muscular layer of the heart due to the narrowing of the coronary arteries leading to the cell death. Diagnostic criteria, that is it should be 75% or more stenosis in major coronary arteries in a coronary angiogram, and ejection fraction less than 40%, NOS symptoms plus 2 or more. Ischemic cardiomyopathy has high mortality with medical treatment. Improved survival maybe with viable myocardium. If PCI or CABG is done, then survivability is more. Effort should be made to detect the viable muscle. This is important. Here is the algorithm, that is if ischemic cardiomyopathy have the coronary artery disease, then assess the myocardial viability and technique, the no evidence of viability less than 25%, then medical treatment, and later on we'll discuss the cardio recent personal therapy or ICD, internal cardiac defibrillator, to prevent the sudden death, the ventricular assisted device. If the presence of significant viability in segments substandard by the systolic function, then coronary revascular, PCI or CVG should be done. If no coronary artery disease, then investigate alternate etiology of the dilated cardiac. Here I show the difference between the dilated cardiomyopathy and ICM. That is, the in dilated cardiomyopathy, there is all the cardiac chambers are dilated, and in ICM there is regional. That is, usually the left ventricle is dilated, and global hypokinesia, here the regional hypokinesia, and dyskinesia not seen in the dilated cardiomyopathy. In ICM there is a dyskinesia seen. RV involvement is often in the dilated cardiomyopathy. RV involvement is rare in the ischemic cardiomyopathy. Now, diagnosis of the dilated cardiomyopathy as a whole. That is history from physical examination, ECG, chest X-ray, echocardiogram, ETT, cardiac catheterization, CT scan, MRI, myocardial biopsy, and the genetic testing is needed. And history, that is, some history will suggest that the which like there is peripartum status or in ischemic heart disease or diabetes mellitus or SLE or endocrine or valvular disease, that is aortic regurgitation or mitral regurgitation, which may lead to the valvular cardiomyopathy. Early stages, there may be no sign or symptoms, but in advanced stages, there is a breathlessness on exertion or even at rest, edema and ascites and fatigue, then chest discomfort, dizziness, lightheadedness, fainting. These are maybe the symptoms. And signs, that is the pulse, there may be sinus tachycardia, there may be sinus bradycardia, and all sorts of arrhythmia. There is atrial fibrillation, extra-systolic, non-sustained VT and VT, all are maybe documented with the ECG. Blood pressure, there is low blood pressure and narrow pulse pressure. JVP is usually elevated. Pericardium apex is shifted, and palpable PT and left paraspinal if the pulmonary hypertension is already developed. And on auscultation, S1, S2, soft, P2 loud from the pulmonary hypertension, and systolic murmur at mitral and tricuspid area due to the mitral development of the mitral regurgitation and tricuspid regurgitation. Mitral regurgitation is developed maybe due to the annular dilatation. S3 and S4 are common. ECG findings already I mentioned, that is the sinus bradycardia, tachycardia, and low voltage ECG. There is a atricular and ventricular arrhythmia, pseudo infraction. If the there is ischemic cardiomyopathy, then there is a Q wave in the vessel. And there is a pattern of in the LVB pattern, RVB pattern, bifascicular or trifascicular also can be found. And there is atrioventricular block. ECG, there is a LVB pattern on the ECG. And X-ray, there is a cardiomegaly. It has some different diagnosis with the pericardial infection or multivalvular disease. Pulmonary edema with curly B-line, pleural effusion may be present in the pulmonary, usually no LA enlargement or say it's a single right border, no calcified valve or normal level. Echocardiography, MMOT shows the valves are usually normal in morphology with reduced excursion. EPS is increased. Mitral valve shows the penguin appearance in the C-shape. And the 2D echo, already I mentioned, the four chambers are usually dilated. In case of ischemic cardiomyopathy, only segmented, there is regional, there is LV dilatation found. LV1 keen with hypokinesia. Color Doppler usually shows the functional MR and TR with trivial air. Echocardiography, there is all dilated, chambers are dilated. The chambers are dilated. And this is endocardial myopathy. It shows the interstitial fibrosis mainly. And this is the non-disintegration of the myocarditis with the MRI. management of dilated cardiomyopathy. I have the heading that's the general management, and it's the drug therapy and intervention and surgical management. That is, drug therapy has to treat the heart failure, to prevent the thromboembolic complication, and to prevent sudden cardiac death. General maintenance, that is, avoid alcohol. That is, all the predisposing factors should be average. That is, limit exercise, weight reduction, control of blood pressure, control of diabetes, correction of anemia and malnutrition, prompt control of infection. Treatment of heart failure, that is, rest and salt and water restriction, diuretics, vasodilators, that is, ACE inhibitors, ARB inhibitors, beta blockers, sacubitril or valsartan combination, that is, angiotensin receptor neprilysin inhibitors, that is, ARNI, or it's changed dramatically the treatment of heart failure. Now it is just recently, that is, dapagliflozin has having the property to treat the heart failure, usually the with diabetes mellitus, that is, non-insulin diabetes mellitus. Intravenous dopamine, dovitamine, or renin is needed when the hypertension is the feature to counter the shock. And to prevent the thromboembolic complication, anti-arrhythmic drugs should be used. If atrial fibrillation, then digoxin, and others that is non-sustained VT or ventricular fibrillation, amiodarone can be used. And long-term anticoagulant therapy, that is systemic and pulmonary to prevent systemic and pulmonary embolism, that is warfarin, and nowadays rivaroxaban, non-vitamin K-dependent antagonist, that is rivaroxaban also can be used. Intervention, that is to treat the dilated cardiomyopathy. If there is ischemic cardiomyopathy, already I mentioned that PCI and CAVC advised to treat the coronary artery disease if viable and vital and present. And ICD, patient with documented arrhythmias or a history of unexplained syncope should be treated aggressively, usually with an implantable cardioverter defibrillator. Prevention of sudden cardiac death with implementum ICD is efficacious. And CRT, I will discuss later, for heart failure and to prevent the sudden cardiac death and cardiac transmission. Here is the implantable of a cardiac defibrillator. Patients with severely depressed myocardial function should be monitored or for arrhythmias, and if present, then aggressively treated with the antiperitoneal. If it is not combat the arrhythmia, then implantable cardioverter defibrillator should be used to prevent the sudden cardiac death. Cardiac risk information, now it is the emerging treatment for the heart failure. It is the hope. That is, cardiac reconstruction therapy is the insertion of the electrodes in the left and right ventricles of the heart, as well as occasionally the right atrium, to treat heart failure by coordinating the function of the left and right ventricle via pacemaker. That's in the heart failure, there is always a discoordination between the contraction of the left ventricle and right ventricle. The CRT causes it's in the coordination of this movement. Selection criteria of the CRT, that is, patient with sinus rhythm, left ventricular ejection fraction less than 35% or equal to 30%, dimension more than 120 milliseconds or more, and NOSA class 3 and or ambulatory heart failure symptoms despite optimal medical therapy. Cardiac reconstruction therapy, it causes the improved hemodynamics, that is, increased cardiac output, reduced left ventricular filling pressure, reduced symptomatic activity, sympathetic activity, increased systolic function, and reverse remodeling of the decreased left ventricular systolic diameter or volume and increased left ventricular ejection fraction. Newly emerging treatment for the dilated cardiomyopathy, that is, immunosuppressive and immunomodulation therapy, gene therapy, cellular transmission, that is, fetal cardiomyocytes, skeletal myoblasts, adult stem cell, embryonic stem cell. Hopefully, these will be help us in future more commonly. Complication of the dilated cardiomyopathy, already I said, the pathophysically it's ultimately convert to the heart failure. There is heart failure and lots of arrhythmias, and all sorts of arrhythmias, there is systemic and pulmonary embolism, syncope, and cardiac death, all are the complication of the dilated cardiomyopathy. Prognosis, the course of disease is progressively downhill, although some patients may remain stable for years. Treatment of heart failure may result in temporary remission, but relapses are common in time. Patients become resistant to therapy. Prognosis for survival beyond a year is poor. 50% die within 2 years of diagnosis. Now, I come to the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is a disease of cardiac myocytes, then can be grouped into familial or genetic or non-familial non-genetic subtypes. Here the characters, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy characterized by the cardiac hypertrophy in the absence of abnormal loading conditions like hypertension or aortic stenosis, which causes the cardiac hypertrophy, that is not present there. Less able to pump blood effectively with a normal or increased ejection fraction. Prevalence of sex, male and female ratio, all are equal. Usually in the adult is affected, and frequency in 1 in 500 people, 25% of the first degree relatives. 70% of patients have obstructive form of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. There is hypertrophy of the muscles in several sites, most common with the asymmetric septal hypertrophy, the septum and pleural wall, that is 70%. Basal septal hypertrophy, 15 to 20%. Concentric LVs, there is 8 to 10%. Apical or lateral wall, less than 2%. But it is characterized by the giant PO inversion laterally and spread level. It is in Japan and Asia, it is more common, around 25%. Etiology, that is already I mentioned, there is genetic and non-genetic. In genetically, that is up to 60% patient have of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is an autosomic dominant trait, may be caused by the mutation in cardiac sarcomere and protein genes. 5% of adult cases are caused by the other genetic disorder, including inherited metabolic and neuromuscular diseases, chromosome abnormalities, and genetic syndromes. Pathology, the pathologic hallmarks of the disease here, the asymmetrical septal hypertrophy, cardiomyocyte hypertrophy, and dysarthria, and interstitial and replacement and fibrosis, small vessel abnormalities, that is dysplastic arterioles, electrical remodeling of the cardiomyocytes. Diagnosis, there is history and physical examination, and ECG, echocardiography, contrast echocardiography, transcranial echography, I will discuss later. There is symptoms, that is maybe asymptomatic, may not have sign or symptoms in the early stages of the disease, the time takes to develop over time. The sign and symptoms include, that is chest pain, especially with the physical exertion, shortness of breath, especially with physical exertion, fatigue, dizziness, lightheadedness, arrhythmias, and fainting, there is syncope, and swelling of the ankle when the burnout cardiomyopathy is developed later. End stage cardiomyopathy, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Physical findings, that is pulse are rapid, rise with dysphagia continuum, and apical impulse is a little forceful, left atrial contraction against the long compress will get forceful, and jugular venous pulse prominent AOF, there is a murmur, there is grade 3-6 murmur due to the LVOT gradient if the more than 30 millimeter mercury. And medium P systolic ejection marker at the lower left external body border and the apex. It varies in intensity with the magnitude of the subaortic gradient and some maneuver, there is Valsalva maneuver or exercise, which causes the decreased preload and decreased afterload, which increases the left ventricular outflow gradient and increases the murmur. Here, that is this showing that this is decrease by increased preload afterload volume distribution. That means if the vasodilating drug is used, then it causes the more gradient. And ECG is abnormal in the majority, then around 95% of the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patients. But the most common is there is a repolarization abnormalities, that is ST segment depression or TOF inversion, left ST degeneration around 30%, abnormal QRS 25 to 30%, increased QRS voltage, diffuse symmetric and T inversion in the precordial and inferior that lead, it is the apical hypertrophy, the ventricular pre-excitation and active ventricular block. Most patients have normal sinus rhythm, but supraventricular tachycardia 34 to 46%, premature ventricular contraction 43%, and non-sustained ventricular tachycardia 25% are frequent during ambulatory ECG monitoring. Atrial fibrillation occurs 25 to 30%, you know, usually in the older population. Here is the, that is a deep T inversion. And in echocardiography, the diagnostic criteria is the hypertrophy defined by the presence of increased LV wall thickness, that is, if it is more than 15 millimeter in one or more segments, and more than 30 millimeter diagnostic if the first degree relative of someone with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy measured by imaging techniques or echocardiography. In echocardiography, 2DM mode, so the asymmetrical septal hypertrophy, already I mentioned, that is a ratio of septal and posterior wall thickness between 1.3 to 1.5. Systolic anterior motion of the mitral valve, that is called SAM. Here, an abrupt anterior movement of the mitral valve reaches its peak before maximum movement of the posterior wall. A small left ventricular cavity, enlarged left atrium, and septal immobility, premature closure of the aortic valve. Mitral valves have some shows change. There is a prolapse of the mitral valves, can be caudal elongation, elongation of the mitral leaflets, which spoke at the leaflet body rather than the tip, anterior displacement of the mitral apparatus, insertion of the papillary muscle directly into the anterior mitral leaflets. And there is a systolic function, usually normal or increased, both in non-obstructive and obstructive variety. Systolic function, already I mentioned, decrease in 10 to 15% in case of in-stage or burnout hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Diastolic function is usually dysfunction developed, that is due to LV and LV filling abnormality, irrespective of the presence or extent of the other LVs. That is due to prolongation of the isovolumetric relaxation time. There is aortic valve closure to the mitral valve closure, increased LV filling pressure, decreased ventricular volume, and in mitral inflow pattern shows these findings, that the reduced EF velocity, increased AF velocity, and EF ratio decrease. And mechanism of the, I can just a little bit, that is the systolic anterior motion. It is usually asked in the examination, that's why I show the mechanism of the SAM. There is mainly two effects are contributing to develop the SAM. That is the drag effect or Bernoulli effect. Here the hydrodynamic pushing force of flow behind the mitral leaflets, which causes, it plays the dominant role, and it increases the LV-OT gradient. Venturi effect, that is anterior mitral valve leaflets and powder sucked into the outflow tract. It has also role, but minority. Consequence of SAM, that is systolic anterior motion, you can handle hemodynamic consequence of the SAM, that is prolongation of the ejection tract time and reduction in stroke volume, cooperation of the mitral valve leaflets may be disrupted, resulting in mitral regurgitation, missed systolic notching of the aortic valve, the drag forces that creates SAM, I already mentioned, that LV gradient is increased. Extent of the septal hypertrophy and resultant narrowing of the LVOT also contribute to the LVOT gradient. Color Doppler echography, that is the MR, presents almost all type of obstructive hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and as a consequence of the SAM, which induces abnormal mitral leaflet absorption. In case of, if mitral regurgitation is due to SAM, then the jet will direct it posteriorly. And if it is mitral regurgitation is due to intrinsic mitral valve disease, due to annular, papular, or leaflet disease, patients with obstruction and mitral regurgitation can show a systolic mitral anterior detected disease. That is, if it is intrinsic disease of the mitral valve, it is directed anteriorly, and if it is due to SAM, it is directed posteriorly. Pulse Doppler, that is the isovolumetric relaxation period is prolonged, rate of rapid filling is diminished, atrial contribution to filling is increased, as well as the due to the left ventricular chamber is the stiffness development. Now, exercise echocardiography, which is needed sometimes to diagnose the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, because the only around 25% having the more than 30 millimeter of mercury LV aortic gradient in 25% cases. Most of the cases, there are around 50% cases with having the labile obstruction or latent obstruction or dynamic retention. Here, in resting condition, they are below the 30 millimeter mercury. But if physiologically or pharmacologically provocation was done, that is Valsalva maneuver, amyl nitrate, dobutamine, this causes the increase the LV aortic gradient more than 35 millimeter mercury. And non-obstructive variety around 25%, that is always less than 30. The tissue Doppler also can be here. We just skipping. There is other modalities are contrast echography, strain rate imaging, and 3D echo. And complication, that is arrhythmia, which leads to the sudden cardiac death and stroke, and valve infection, that is mitral regurgitation, which can make up the infected part of the disease, and last of all, there is heart failure, maybe also death. Treatment. General measures, that is avoid dehydration, avoid exercise, and weight loss should be encouraged. Arterial and venous dilators, nitrates, the phosphorylated fibrinogen should be avoided, because already I mentioned this decreases the preload and afterload, which increases the LV aortic gradient and causes the sudden cardiac death. New onset or poorly controlled atrial fibrillation should be managed by prompt restoration of sinus rhythm or ventricular rate control. If hemodynamic anastomosis, then cardioversion should be done. Digoxin should be avoided in patients with the left ventricular outflow tract obstruction because of its positive inotropic effect. Pharmacological management, there is beta blocker up to a maximum tolerated dose. There is metoprolol, bisoprolol, sotalol can be used. Disopyramide can be used, and verapamil can be used when beta blockers are contraindicated or ineffective. Now, invasive management of the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy to reduce the left ventricular outflow tract obstruction should be considered when the left ventricular outflow tract obstruction is more than 50 millimeter mercury, moderate to severe symptoms, that is NOSA class 3 or 4, recurrent exertion. Recurrent syncope, exceptional, that is other history is not giving, that is syncope, in spite of maximally tolerated drug therapy. In this all cases, left ventricular outflow tract obstruction should be treated. And there is a surgical treatment, there is ventricular septal myomectomy, there is Moro procedure, long-term symptom, it is relief around 80%. And reduce the LV outflow tract gradient in over 90% of cases, reduce SAM-related mitral regurgitation, and improves exercise capacity and symptoms of patients with long-term survival comparable to death. And nowadays, there is another intervention, that is septal ablation, can be done by alcohol, coils, and direct endocavitary ablation, that is radiofrequency ablation, nowadays can be done to several times. And dual chamber pacing is sometimes helpful, usually in the older patient, to coordinate the movement of the ventricles. Clinical feature associated with the increased risk of sudden death. There is age, younger patients are more vulnerable, and the non-sustained VT in diagnosed. The LV wall thickness, greater risk more than the 30 millimeter, and the chance of sudden cardiac death is more as LV wall thickness is more. LA diameter also causes the higher risk, and gradient LV outflow tract obstruction, high gradients increase risk, so importance of the provocal gradient in effective treatment is unclear. And more extensive fibrosis demonstrated by MRI is also leading to the chance of sudden cardiac death. Now, the management of heart failure, already I mentioned that there is some patients develop in the heart failure. Here there is an algorithm. There is heart failure with NYHA class 3-4. If the LVOT is more than 50 millimeter mercury, then management of LVOT, that just I mentioned, that is septal ablation or myomectomy, if the drug is not controlled the symptom. And if the resting or provocable left ventricular outflow tract obstruction is less than 50, and if it associated atrial fibrillation, then rate and rhythm control should be done, rate by anti-arrhythmic drug and thromboembolic contribution, that is the rivaroxaban or warfarin. And if again, if this is having the left ventricular ejection fraction more than 50%, then beta blocker, verapamil, diltiazem, and low dose loop diuretics can be used cautiously. And left ventricular ejection fraction less than 50%, here we AC inhibitor and ARB also can be used, which cannot be used if the left ventricular ejection would be 50%. And last of all, consider the cardiac transplantation. Here there is atrial fibrillation, already I mentioned it. In-stage cardiomyopathy in HCM, there is a burnout phase, that is 5% can be developed to the in-stage hypertrophic. It shows also the features like similar to the in-stage cardiomyopathy. The ejection fraction usually less than 50%. After load reducing agents, that is beta blocker, diuretics, ICD, biventricular pacing, advanced surgical therapy, should be considered. And cardiac transplantation is the last stop. I will just discuss the athletes, as we always sometimes confusing with the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. There is isolated voltage sky area of the LVS or left axis deviation, we sometimes confuse with the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, but QF inversion is especially in the lateral lead segment depression, and pathological QFs are more likely, that is, it is a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. In case of sometimes in QF inversion in B1 to B2, seen in the black athletes, and in case of the white athletes, it is 3 to 5%. Now, is it differentiating with the athletes' hearts and hypertrophic cardiomyopathy? If it is more than 15 millimeter, is surely that is a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And if it is less than, that is, we can think that. But there is a gray zone, that is between 13 to 15 millimeter. Then we consider this features. There is a LV cavity usually less than 45 millimeter in case of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, which is enlarged in the 55 millimeter in the athlete's diameter. And marked LA enlargement in the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, normal LA size. These are the features, and also the family history of the ACM is also can be contributing to differentiate the athletic hearts and hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Now I am coming to the restrictive cardiomyopathy. It is a rare form of a heart muscle disease and causes a heart failure, that is comprises 5% of all cases of cardiomyopathy. Normal or decreased volume of both ventricles associated with biatrial enlargement, normal or increased alveolar thickness and aortic valves, impaired ventricular filling with restricted physiology, normal or near normal systolic function. Its prevalence varies depending on regionality, ethnicity, age, and gender. Both sporadic and family forms are mixed, because in the classification we say that the restrictive cardiomyopathy is also has the mixed variety, that is genetics and acquired. Etiology, most causes of the restrictive cardiomyopathy are acquired, that is inflammatory, non-inflammatory, inflammatory, and storage and idiopathic. Inflammatory, that is endomyocardial disease and the low flux cardiomyopathy, postpartum. Inflammatory, that is amyloidosis, sarcoidosis, is one of the diseases causes the restrictive cardiomyopathy. And non-inflammatory, there's hypertrophic, familial, diabetic, and scleroderma. Pathophysiology with symptoms and signs, that means pathophysiology, there's a backward failure developed, that is the increased RA pressure causing systemic venous congestion, edema, hepatomegaly, ascites. Increased LA pressure, that leads to pulmonary congestion, shortness of breath, and crepitation. And in case of forward failure, limited to preload and stroke volume, reduced cardiac output, fatigue is causes. Here, if the volume overload, that is a fatigue, dyspnea, orthopnea can be done. Arrhythmia causes the palpitation. And reduced cardiac output, that is forward failure, causes the exercise intolerance, congestive difficulties. Angina, dyspnea, and sudden cardiac death can be also the features. Pulse showing the tachycardia, bradycardia, weak peripheral pulse, blood pressure is really low. Jugular venous can show the S1 and S2 in rhythm. Diagnosis can be done by the ECG or echocardiography. And first of all, there should be conscious mind to thinking that it may be the restrictive cardiac. There is history of is also is important. That is the ECG, biatrial enlargement, SVT change, conduction defect, low QRS complex, atrial fibrillation, and ventricular tachycardia. Echocardiography, there is show that is small steep ventricles. Preserved systolic function until the last stage, that is cardiac failure, dilated atria, the diastolic function can be detected by Doppler. Many disorders manifested, there is restrictive physiology and must be excluded by the cardiac. Cardiac catheterization can be done and cardiac magnetic MRI, myocardial to detect the myocardial infiltration, inflammation, and fibrosis, and assess the pericardium, thereby helping establish underlying disease. There is sometimes pericardium may be involved. Tissue biopsy for definitive diagnosis in some disorder, that is amyloidosis, sarcoidosis, systemic lupus erythematosus, polycythemia, myositis. Treatment, there is no specific treatment. The mainstays of the medical treatments include, so there is how to treatment the heart flow, that is diuretics, vasodilator, ACE inhibitors, as well as the anticoagulation, if not contraindicated. However, therapies directed as individual person, especially there is if steroid for the sarcoidosis and low flux endocarditis, endocardiectomy for endomyocardial fibrosis and low flux endocarditis, phlebotomy and chelation for hemochromatosis and thermotherapy for amyloidosis, novel therapies such as RNA interference molecules that target abnormal protein production for familial amyloidosis. In case of to avoid the side effects of the corticosteroid, we can use the budesonide. There is arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, an uncommon form of inheritable heart muscle disease. That is around 1 to 5,000. A recognized cause of sudden cardiac death in the young persons involves predominantly the right ventricle with progressive loss of myocytes and fatty or fibrofatty tissue replacement, resulting in regional or global abnormalities. The ventricular involvement with fibrofatty replacement, chamber enlargement, and myocarditis is reported in up to 75% of patients. Although frequently associated with myocarditis, that is enterovirus or pneumonia in some cases, in most cases, atrial arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy or dysplasia shows autosomal dominant inheritance. Presenting clinically with ventricular tachyarrhythmia, that is monochromic ventricular tachycardia, non-invasive clinical diagnosis may be confounded without an easily obtained single test.
আপনার শেয়ারিংটা বোধহয় বন্ধ হয়ে গেছে, শেয়ারিং শুরু করতে হবে।
সিজার স্যার শুনছেন স্যার? কারেন্ট চলে গেল নাকি সিজার স্যার?
সিজার ভাই মনে হয় কারেন্ট চলে গেছে।
আই থিংক লাইট ইজ অফ।
লাইন ইজ অফ।
স্যার স্যারের লাইনটা অফ স্যার।
হ্যাঁ। আপু আপনি কারেন্ট চলে গেছে, সো ইউ হ্যাভ টু ওয়েট আ লিটল বিট।
স্যার আমি একটু ফোনে যোগাযোগ করছি
স্যার। হি ইজ ট্রাইং টু গেট জব বিকজ আই থিংক হি হ্যাজ সামারাইজড থ্রি বিগ চ্যাপ্টার ইনটু ওয়ান।
ইয়া ইয়া
আই এম ইমপ্রেসড।
উই ক্যান ডিসকাস নাও?
উই ক্যান স্টার্ট ডিসকাসিং।
ইয়া
Why not? I'll be asking the students to ask questions.
Dr. Aftab Idin, Dr. Aftab, do you hear me? Dr. Murshid, do you hear me?
You know, during exam time,
do you hear me?
Musin.
Yes, sir.
Let me continue talking as an examiner. During exam time, cardiomyopathy come into importance in three different forms. In written exam, we often give a scenario, young patient coming with syncope. What are the possibilities? One of them, young patient, good LV function. There's only two information, coming with syncope. No channelopathies, but there is a systolic murmur in the pericardium. Obviously, I'm actually pointing to hypertrophic cardiomyopathy as a cause. Or a young patient coming to you with monomorphic VT. Apparently, null heart.
স্যার একটু দৃষ্টি আকর্ষণ করছি সিজার স্যারের হচ্ছে পাওয়ারের কানেকশনটা অফ হয়ে গিয়েছিল উনি স্যার কানেক্ট করে স্যার আবার আমাদের
স্যার ঢোকেন ঢোকার পরে আমরা আবার ওটা তার ইয়েতে রেখে শেষ করব লেট আস কন্টিনিউ
জি স্যার লেট আস কন্টিনিউ
আমরা একটু আলাপ করি স্যার
ফর এক্সাম্পল মনোমরফিক ভিটি এন্ড দ্যাট কুড বি ওয়ান অফ দ্য কজ দ্য ইয়াংগিশ পেশেন্ট কামিং লাইক দিস পারসিস্টেন্ট ভিটি ইজ arthrotic VT or arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia. Exam, if he got a good case of HCM, we give a patient as a long case or a short case. In the ECG, we give him an ECG with LV to the strain pattern and a particular strain, the ECG with the LVH and the T wave is very much upright in AVR with such a HCM. We do ask questions like that. In the echo, we often give you an echo, maybe 2D or Doppler or an M mode. If the SAM is present or not, the degree of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, the muscle wall thickness, what you see, what are the criteria for ICD implantation, who are the patient at risk for sudden cardiac death. These are the very pet question that we examiners ask. Mohsin, yes, you want to add something?
Yeah, sir. What is the importance, sir? What is the definition of cardiomyopathy, sir? Sometimes examiner asked in a question, what is the definition of cardiomyopathy, sir? It is the actually some of the examinee tell it is the abnormal dilation of the heart, or sometimes called the hypertrophy of the heart. I think Professor Caesar, sir, first slide, it is the important thing to memorize for the students.
Yeah.
What is the cardiomyopathy definition? Because it is a heterozygous group of disorder. There may be, sir, you said before, you know, the abnormal myocytes, also the arrhythmia, also some dilatation or hypertrophy. Because due to unknown etiology, cannot explain, unexplained, should be mentioned in the definition, I should say. Another is definition of ischemic cardiomyopathy. What is the definition of ischemic cardiomyopathy? Sir, could you tell some about the ischemic cardiomyopathy definition?
This time, Professor Mamnoor Rashid has beautifully shown in a slide the definition of ischemic cardiomyopathy. Previously, it was told that it should not be included. Actually, all sorts of heart failure of different etiology, ultimately the heart becomes dilated, ends up as a dilated cardiomyopathy. That may be of valvular origin, that may be tachycardia induced, that may be chemical induced, that may be idiopathic, that may be hypertensive heart failure resulting later on into this or the ischemia. Now we can, when the heart is dilated, ejection fraction is less, there is regional pulmonary abnormality, and the patient have evidence of MI. When the ejection fraction is low, heart is dilated, it's dilated cardiomyopathy of ischemic origin. Then we can call it ischemic cardiomyopathy. And Professor Caesar has shown in his life, that's beautifully.
So that is that history of MI or ECG showed MI. That is QA in the ECG, number one.
Yeah.
Then original push-up abnormality, EF less than 30%. And angiography showed at least 70% lesion in the midpoint.
At least one epicardial coronary artery.
Or a single vessel or ostial part of the LAD. So she defined it as QA in the ECG. Nodul sir, do you have something? Professor Nodul sir?
Okay, actually, good discussion already started by Professor Mohsin and Wadu. Actually, look, the term cardiomyopathy itself is sometimes it is named to be a misnomer because any disease of the cardiac myocardium is cardiomyopathy. And the scientists and the faculty fraternity has a long way to go from here. And this definition of cardiomyopathy has been done many times. The initial study that was more descriptive was in 1980s WHO's classification, where cardiomyopathy is actually defined as a primary disease of the myocardium. And this was another term that was known as specific myocardial diseases, specific heart diseases. That included other diseases like music is there. Is that many a times you can see in the books, the journals, two terms. One is cardiomyopathy, almost like a singular number. Another is cardiomyopathies. When you call cardiomyopathy,
volume
included all the cardiomyopathies actually in the primary. And in these cardiomyopathies,
So
when we use cardiomyopathies, then we classify these into three or four types, like hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, dilated cardiomyopathy. In fact, dilated cardiomyopathy was previously known as congestive cardiomyopathy and restrictive type. And these are the terms. But in any case, these phenotypes are actually totally different. Actually, there is a lot of different causes for hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and most of the causes are not equal to the dilated cardiomyopathy at present, what we're doing, even in the restrictive cardiomyopathy. So look, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy goes more towards hypertensive heart disease, dilated cardiomyopathy goes more towards heart failure, and restrictive cardiomyopathy goes most towards pericardial diseases and restrictive infiltrative diseases. So if you think in this way, morphological aspect, together with their functional aspect, actually differentiate this. So this is the thing. Next to this, next point is about hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is a long-term disease, and by its course till now, it has at least 18 to 20 names. 18 to 20 names. The initial names was IHSS, idiopathic hypertrophic subaortic stenosis. And ultimately, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy was taken, and they have got many classifications. So actually, Caesar has done a wonderful thing, and they make it everything in a cardiomyopathy umbrella. And it is a very difficult job to say almost everything or all the necessary things in one lecture. But anyway, he's been pretty fine. So up to now, this is my comment, and maybe I can come it later. Thank you, Mohsin.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Khalid Mohsin, sir, do you have something?
Big chapter. Yeah, thank you. Dr. Caesar has made a very enviable job. Actually, dilated cardiomyopathy and hypertrophic cardiomyopathy are relatively common, but restrictive cardiomyopathy is relatively uncommon. And once we are doing echocardiogram, we have to have a very high index of suspicion. Otherwise, we may miss the diagnosis. And in examination, there is one clinical scenario when the candidates asked how you can differentiate between hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and aortic stenosis. It's a very good one, a very pet question of the examiners in the examination. And we have to, in the examining the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, we have to look for the double apical impulse. It's often very much present, and the fourth heart sound. If these two findings are found, it is quite easy. And in ECG, there is a sign called the triple T sign. This is the T inverted in 1 and 2 and upright in lead 3. This gives another clue. Professor Vadud has mentioned about the AVR. And in case of dilated cardiomyopathy, poor RV progression in the precordial leads, particularly in a female patient, should give us a high index of suspicion. So thank you. Thanks to Dr. Sridhar for brilliantly presenting such a vast topic in 1 hour. Thank you so much.
One thing is that for echo diagnosis of restrictive cardiomyopathy, I would often say, whenever, I'll talk in later. Sridhar Bhai, welcome back. We are actually waiting. We are praising you actually. Can we start? It's all right. We are actually praising you so much. You have done a great job. Now, please go on.
I am most probably I am with the arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. That is presenting clinically with ventricular tachymetry. Already I mentioned non-invasive clinical diagnosis may be confounding. Always thinking that already I mentioned without an easily obtained single test or finding that can diagnose the. Generally requires an integrated assessment of electrical, functional, and anatomic abnormalities. Diagnosis of already I mentioned often requires there is high index of suspicion. The presentation with arrhythmia, syncopes, and cardiac waves, as well as the global or segmental chamber dilatation and valvular abnormality. And here diagnosis should be done by the with the history of the family history and the, should be with. There is the possibility of amyloidosis, sarcoidosis, and other these. So these are rare diseases. So always thinking should be done that some things maybe the arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy. Non-invasive tests include there is 12-lead ECG, there is abnormal deployation of TOV inversion in leads V1 through V3, and a small amplitude production at the end of QRS complex, epsilon wave, Bragoda syndrome, which may be presented with it. Echocardiography can be then right ventricular angiography, cardiac magnetic resonance imaging, and computer tomography. Endomyocardial biopsy from the right ventricular fluid is a sensitive diagnostic marker when fibrillatory infiltration is associated with cerebral stenosis myopathy. Gene mapping can be done. There is usually there is autosomic dominant form and two recessive forms. There is actional. Placoglobulin and desmoplakin respectively. Treatment are to treat the antiarrhythmic drug for controlling the arrhythmia, drugs for treat the heart failure, and ICD to prevent the sudden cardiac death. Thank you very much for patience hearing. Sorry for the interruption with power loss.
Thank you. So nicely presented the elaborate all the topics in a single lecture. Thank you, Sridhar Bhai, again. We are enjoying a lot. We are already start discuss your absence. So, Vadu sir, please.
We were talking about diagnosing restrictive cardiomyopathy. It's a very important thing. I always say, whenever in echo, you find out both the atria are quite large compared to the ventricles. Always consider two things. Is it restrictive cardiomyopathy? Is it constitutive pericarditis. Atria, quite big, both of them are enlarged, ventricle, relatively small. Kobichan Bhai, are you here?
Yes, sir. Apni slide share take to screen take to stop for them.
Yes, sir. I am in court.
Acha, Kobichan Bhai, are you here?
Yes,
sir. Do you want to elaborate on that? Restrictive cardiomyopathy. Because restrictive cardiomyopathy, in a frank form, we can diagnose. But in an earlier form, what are the basic clinic echocardiographic clue that can actually point us that it could be restrictive cardiomyopathy?
Actually, it is the Khaled Mohsin, I have clearly mentioned, is the high degree of suspicion that one makes they're able to diagnose the restrictive cardiomyopathy. Because it's a very tricky diagnosis. Many of the features will like constrictive pericarditis, but if you find that the two atrium are remarkably enlarged, the systolic contraction of the both ventricles are in the normal limit, and if you get some sort of PSP is high, and obviously tissue Doppler will clarify you that ventricular muscular contraction is within our limit. So these are the components that will make you more or less sure that this is restrictive cardiomyopathy. But first suspicion is the dilatation of the both atria.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Compared to the ventricles.
A simple question for the students, sir. Kobudjavan, sir. As Professor Caesars are nicely described echocardiography, but for the diagnosis of the cardiomyopathy, most important tools is the echocardiography. For the managing purpose for the MPI, perfusion imaging, the two topics in imaging role in the cardiomyopathy. So discuss about the echo role in the cardiomyopathy, sir.
Actually, echo is the diagnostic for cardiomyopathy.
Yes.
Again, if you want to search for a viability of the myocardium, then you can go for the MPI.
MPI, yes.
Suspect.
That's actually for ICM.
Yeah.
Yes. You were talking about the ischemic cardiomyopathy.
Yeah.
Actually, ischemic cardiomyopathy is a component, a type of cardiomyopathy. Whenever there are some territory of the myocardium that shows inappropriate decreased contraction, inappropriate to the degree of narrowing of the corresponding coronaries. As for example, right coronary only have the 20 to 30% stenosis. That may not cause any hypokinesia, but that territory is also showing the hypokinesia. Other territories such as a LED territory, say there are 80 to 95% stenosis, that may cause hypokinesia. But RCA territory, as for example, that not remarkably narrowed, that you can say that this may cause the hypokinesia. These are the disproportionate stenosis causing the wall motion abnormality.
Unexplained.
Yes, that's why the cardiomyopathy.
Yeah.
Actually, whenever we call the cardiomyopathy, ischemic cardiomyopathy, actually when there is wall motion abnormality, global wall motion abnormality, some part is akinetic, some part is mild hypokinetic, some part is but all segments involve the some sort of hypokinesia. The patient have previous history of myocardial infarction or the documentation have a significant coronary disease. That is the ischemic cardiomyopathy. And these sets of patients may need MPI. If you want to seek, the patient may get, will this patient get benefit from revascularization? Then you can go for the MPI.
Thank you.
One question for Caesar Bhai, Professor Mamunur Rashid. Actually, his nickname is very famous, our beloved Caesar Bhai. One question is that, which is the most common arrhythmia in cardiomyopathy patient? Can you elaborate the three different types, dilated, hypertrophic, and restrictive? Which type of arrhythmia is common in different types of cardiomyopathies?
MPI?
Arrhythmia.
There is a, in non-sustained ventricular tachycardia is common in the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And in case of dilated cardiomyopathy, that is when in case atrial fibrillation is common. And in case of it is ventricular, there is non-sustained ventricular tachycardia, but premature ventricular contraction is
wrong. I would differ a little bit. In restrictive cardiomyopathy, the large atria actually predisposes it to more atrial arrhythmias, supraventricular arrhythmias.
Supraventricular tachycardia.
AFPSC.
Premature atrial contraction. Premature atrial contraction. There is SVT.
In HCM, both PVC and non-sustained VT, all these are common. In case of dilated cardiomyopathy, we can get everything because everything. Chamber is dilated from PVC to PAC to PF, atrial fibrillation, everything.
Yeah.
My question, I often ask the students, in case of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, atrial fibrillation can be deadly. Why?
Why? Because that is it's to treat the atrial fibrillation. If we use the digoxin, it will use the increases the contractility of the heart, which will also increases the left ventricular outflow tract gradient. So in case of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, to treat the atrial fibrillation more cautiously.
Can I add something else?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, for the stroke output, the heart is very much dependent on the atria. The atrial contribution, you have shown in the echo, the atrial contribution is very much important. Whenever there is AF, the depth contribution is lost. LVDV is already high. Atrial contribution lost. There is very rapid backflow of blood in the pulmonary bed. There is pulmonary edema, and that can be deadly. One. And second is, if you use wrongly digoxin, you are going to increase the mortality. These are two factors. The two factors. Third is, whenever there is a atrial fibrillation and heart failure, we started using loop diuretics and everything, and that induces hypokalemia. That again prompts to develop the arrhythmia, most of VT, VF, again arrhythmia. That's why AF, in case of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, very often is very deadly.
Hey, sir,
thank you.
Some are waiting for question. Attendees. Dr. Aptabidin, your attendees, please ask the question for the panelist. Please unmute yourself.
Can I ask one question?
Dr. Aptab, ask a question to Dr. Arun. Dr. Aptab, ask a question to Dr. Arun. Okay.
Can I ask one question? Postpartum cardiomyopathy after 1 year, 75% recovered. No? So how long do you treat?
Dr. Aptab, you
treat patients when the LV function comes to?
Maske, you are asking that regarding the peripartum cardiomyopathy? Peripartum cardiomyopathy? Several trials already I mentioned. That's some trials shows that there is 25 to 78%. Some says that 75%, and most promising, there is one German trial shows there is 85% recovery with the adequate treatment. And in this trial, there's a bromocaptine also is incorporated. And they showed that the incorporating of the bromocaptine more useful in the treatment. And your question, that is, usually we treated this patient up to the 6 month, and then again follow up echo and her symptom and sign. Then and the trial shows that 1 year after, there is more than 55% ejection fractions remain. Then it is called that the treatment is successful.
So after normal ejection fraction, how long and what medicine should you continue if the ejection fraction is normal?
When the ejection fraction here normal means they are saying that more than 55%. There's more than 50% counted as a normal, and after 1 year, the treatment should not be needed further.
Actually, the literature actually didn't say anything how long it should be following up the patient. Yeah. But when after 1 year, if the patient maintained a more than 55% ejection fraction for at least less say 6 months, we can assume that the patient do not require any more treatment. We can assume, but I have not seen undergo any paper that actually states how long should be watching them. But I have seen it. But my experience is that in our country, I think around 1/4 patient die, around 1/4 patient rapidly improve, and 50% patient they remain very symptomatic with reduced ejection fraction. And most of the time, their ejection fraction do not come up to that well. Around 50%, very many, but few patients actually develop fully normal ejection fraction, 60% or more.
Dr. Tan Singh Yang, do you hear me?
Good evening to everyone. I have two questions here. Regarding the first question is, does cardiomyopathy only involve the muscular layer of the heart, or it can involve any layer? because in cardiomyopathy, there is a frequent conduction problem as well as association with coronary artery disease. This is my first question. And my second question is cardiomyopathy is reversible? Because in Davidson, I read, it stated that left ventricular dysfunction usually recover within 4 to 5 days or some even takes weeks in Takotsubo cardiomyopathy. So is it, it means that it is reversible?
Okay, Cesar, please unmute.
Cesar, please unmute.
Thanks for question. Regarding
yes,
the second question, reversible cardiomyopathy, already I mentioned there is several types. One of them she mentioning, that is a stretched cardiomyopathy or broken heart cardiomyopathy. It is reversible. It can be getting function normally after treating the treatment. And others, some types, that is tachycardia induced cardiomyopathy. And already I mentioned some. These are the reversible cardiomyopathy. And regarding and nowadays, that is in some of the studies shows that in case of dilated cardiomyopathy, that is familial cardiomyopathy, also after using the CRT, some LV function is coming back. Professor Wadud can say more about this. And regarding the her first question. There is in myocarditis and some form of cardiomyopathy, there is the intramural, I mentioned that intramural coronary artery involvement is there, and this leading to the coronary artery, that is coronary artery narrowing and leading to the ischemic heart disease also.
Can I say something?
Yes, sir.
Actually, the question are a misnomer. Because he could not say cardiomyopathy is cardiomyopathy reversible. The question should be, is some of the cardiomyopathies reversible? Yes, some of them are reversible. Not only Takotsubo, the classic example, I will give you an experience. One patient with CKD was evaluated for transplantation. And we found out his ejection fraction is only 25%. 24, 25, something like that. But his ferritin level was 8,000, very high. So obviously he's not ready for transplantation. He was started on chelation or something like that. After 3 years, in a medical, but I was again consulted for a patient. This time he had some other problem. I go back and I can remember that I had seen this patient. Very surprisingly, at that time, his ferritin level was around 2000, 1800 something, and his ejection fraction has gone back to normal. It's around 60%. We started preparing the patient for kidney transplantation, but unfortunately, the patient later on died because of some other problem, some other infection or something. But that gives me the experience. Some of the diseases, if you treat the underlying cause properly, it can go back. For example, sarcoidosis, if you treat it properly, this patient reverses nicely, including the conduction defect. They can reverse totally. So that will depend upon tachycardiomyopathy, tachycardia-induced cardiomyopathies. They can reverse well. Even some other diseases, right, infiltrative disease, if you treat it properly, and yes, the viral myocarditis, many of them actually improves. Nozu sir, do you want to add something?
Actually, the very context of diagnosing and naming cardiomyopathy is very important. In which context and in which disease you are labeling this patient as a cardiomyopathy. For example, you say ischemic cardiomyopathy. Basically, for the former definition, this is not a cardiomyopathy. This is an end-stage myocardial disease of ischemic origin. And anyway, clinically, we use ischemic cardiomyopathy. So ischemic cardiomyopathy, if there is plenty of scar tissue, this cardiomyopathy cannot be reversed back to normal myocardium. Maybe their functional status may be improved. On the other hand, on the other aspect, Professor Wadud has already discussed properly, very elaborately about the peripartum cardiomyopathy. We do not actually know what is the real cause of peripartum cardiomyopathy. So this peripartum cardiomyopathy, for unknown reason, it involves myocardium and its contractile function is maybe temporarily very depressed. And if the cause is very serious, this temporary may not be temporary, this may be permanent. So this stress pump disease will reverse back to normal, maybe totally 100%, or maybe partially normal, or maybe fully normal. So this is the context of this thing. Again, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy basically a hypertrophic disease, and genetic prevalence is very prominent among all the cardiomyopathies. But the main problem of this part cardiomyopathy is the has got derased myocardium. They have got some functional and in the subcellular level, there are a lot of changes. So there are myocardial derangement is there. And due to the long-term hemodynamic derangement, this may go deteriorate. As already Professor Caesar already said, Caesar already mentioned that there will be burnout cases. At certain point, these hypertrophic cardiomyopathy cases may burn out and go into looking like a dilated cardiomyopathy. So in one stage, you cannot diagnose. So this is the main context in which the term you use, because this term is used in various way, and their prognosis is very difficult to say without knowing the context and the basic etiology of that very problem. Regarding involvement of the conducting system, it is very peculiar that even if you see the highest level of dilated cardiomyopathy, the conducting level is mainly in the bundle branch level, not at the main conducting system. Similarly, even in a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, in the early or mid or even moderate severe level, the bundle block level is not there. So this possibly the conducting system tissue are more protected from these etiological causes of all the form of cardiomyopathy, but except that sarcoidosis and some of the infiltrative causes of cardiomyopathy. So only those cardiomyopathies affect mostly myocardium, but they in addition, they can also affect the conducting system and giving rise to arrhythmias. Thank you.
Sir, I asked a question from Rudhu, sir. I had something.
I'm saying some.
Rudhu, sir. Yes, sir.
Sir,
yes.
You are saying that regarding the ischemic cardiomyopathy, actually, treatment of ischemic cardiomyopathy, if it started with before developing the fibrosis, what you mentioned, that's in interstitial fibrosis, if it is not developed, that is the MPI shows that viable myocardium is there, then the treatment of PCI or CABG can reverse the cardiac function in normal. If it is already fibrosis developed, then MPI will show that there is no viable myocardium, then treatment will not help so much. Only CRT nowadays can be improve the systolic function. Thank you.
Regarding ischemic cardiomyopathy seizure, you have wonderfully shown in two slides what are the causes and how algorithmic way how we can treat. I think fantastic. If anybody follows that thing, I think it is better to understand everything about ischemic cardiomyopathy. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, a comment for the diagnosis of cardiomyopathy management. Echocardiography, different modalities, that is tissue Doppler and stain echocardiography, and also MPI, also cardiac MRI, is not Bangladesh. In Bangladesh, we are is underused, utilized. I must ask, sir, comment on this.
Thank you very much.
This is the management for the echocardiography and MPI and cardiac MRI. Mr. Sir,
thank you very much for inviting me to answer this question. Yes. Echocardiography has got extended use in cardiomyopathies, starting from dilated cardiomyopathy, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and the restrictive cardiomyopathy. All the modalities of echocardiography, two-dimensional, pulse Doppler, color Doppler, and now the tissue Doppler and 2D strain, all these modalities has got values in establishing one or other form of diagnosis. For example, we are talking about ischemic cardiomyopathy, and we know
when we get ischemic cardiomyopathy and we know that there are involvement of the coronary arteries, and we feel that if we revascularize those coronary arteries, then the pumping capacity will be reverted to normal. But this is not the case in reality. Only 30% of cases of ischemic cardiomyopathy, when we get a definite triple vessel disease in the coronary angiogram, after revascularization, only 30% of them goes back to show some sort of improvement. But when we do echocardiography, other than MPI, because relatively MPI is less available in our country, and the people behind the interpretation of myocardial perfusion amazing that the that the nuclear guys are often are not the cardiologists. So we want to trust ourselves and we do the stress echocardiography to evaluate to see whether this patient has got contractile reserve. If echocardiography shows some improvement in ejection fraction, then we feel that revascularization is going to help this patient. This is about the stress role of stress echo in ischemic cardiomyopathy. In restrictive cardiomyopathy, there are some definite cause for restrictive cardiomyopathy, especially the amyloidosis, which we think relatively uncommon, but not that uncommon. In those cases, specific pattern is being seen in the 2D strain. That is there is a more strain in the center and the periphery shows less strain. Specific pattern is being seen in the 2D strain pattern. Tissue Doppler is again very useful because in restrictive cardiomyopathy, one has to have very high suspicion that we are probably dealing with a case of restrictive cardiomyopathy. Because restrictive cardiomyopathy is a disease which may not present with cardiac symptoms. More often they present with ascites. And sometimes you get a patient with restrictive cardiomyopathy is presenting with stroke in one hand and ascites in other hand. So your eye will be distracted more from the cardiovascular disease. The patient presenting with stroke due to increased thromboembolism that occurs with restrictive cardiomyopathy. And this patient can also present at the same time with ascites. But as an echocardiographer, if you have a suspicion that this could be that you are dealing with a case of restrictive cardiomyopathy, then probably you can have more step. The key point of this suspicion is, as already have been discussed, the dilatation of the both atrium, which will give you the suspicion. But at the same time, the dilatation of the inferior vena cava gives us a good clue about that we are going to deal with something which could be restrictive cardiomyopathy or which could be constrictive pericarditis. In earlier days, when we didn't have the tissue Doppler, it was relatively difficult to make a differentiation between constrictive pericarditis and the restrictive cardiomyopathy. But now, when we have the tissue Doppler, and if we have the S prime wave, which is directed into the medial and the lateral annulus of the mitral valve, in case of constrictive pericarditis, we get more motion in the medial valve in constrictive pericarditis, since the lateral annulus is attached to the pericardium. So normally, the lateral annulus show more velocity in tissue Doppler than the medial annulus. But when there is constrictive pericarditis, the medial annulus will show more velocity than the lateral valve. This is one of the important diagnostic criteria. But on the other hand, when we deal with restrictive cardiomyopathy, we do have relatively less systolic velocity in the tissue Doppler. So tissue Doppler is one of the very important differentiating point between constrictive, when we want to differentiate between constrictive pericarditis and restrictive cardiomyopathy. So these are the things I had to mention, that not only the two-dimensional and conventional color echocardiography, but the tissue Doppler, the 2D strain and the stress echocardiography has got role in making diagnosis in cardiomyopathy.
Endulas paradoxus.
Also not to forget to look at the right ventricle, because there are some specific type of cardiomyopathy which selectively affect the right ventricle. And right ventricle had long been a neglected ventricle, and we more frequently used to miss this right ventricle. And if we deal with sarcoidosis, if we deal with arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia, and many a times we'll be able to see some abnormality in the right ventricle. And again, at the end stage of the right ventricle, be it sarcoidosis, be it systemic sclerosis, be it amyloidosis, and be it arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia, all these four categories of cardiomyopathy do show similar form of right ventricular echocardiographic change, where it is very difficult to find out which was the root cause. So thank you very much for the time being given.
Thank you. Excellent. Excellent.
Can I add something?
Yes, sir.
Can I add something?
Yes, sir.
For Professor Bishkat sir was talking about ascites. I tell my student, whenever you get disproportionate ascites, what is that? There is a huge ascites, but there is less edema. The hands and legs are very skinny, but the tummy is big. Only two things can do that. One is constitutive pericarditis or restrictive cardiomyopathy group, and second is cirrhosis. So if you get the cirrhotic markers, you go for cirrhosis, or you assist the patient for restrictive cardiomyopathy, constitutive pericarditis. Disproportionate ascites, out of proportion, edema is less, ascites is huge.
Professor Jalal sir, waiting for our question. Professor Jalal sir, your comments and Professor Jalal sir. Sir, unmute yourself, sir.
Yes, it
is. Yes, sir. Unmute again, sir.
Sir, unmute.
স্যার কথা বলে যাচ্ছে তো
স্যার স্যার আপনি আনমিউট হননি স্যার
স্যার একবার স্যার একটা চাপ দেন স্যার লালটার উপরে
স্যার শুনতেছে না স্যার বলে যাচ্ছে
স্যার হয় নাই স্যার স্যার শোনা যাচ্ছে না স্যার মোসিন স্যারকে একটা ফোন দাও আমার মনে হয়
স্যার
বলছে এর মধ্যে আমার বলা আছে থ্যাংক ইউ
ফর
গিভিং মি টাইম সিজার ভাই থ্যাঙ্কস ফর ইউর নাইস ডেলিভারি এন্ড টাইম ইউর দি টপিকস এন্ড ইউ tell elaborately, but in a short, it's a vast cardiomyopathy. Just, Sijarbhai is very known to me. When I was intern, Sijarbhai, Mamun Rushi Sijarbhai was my IMO in 1995. Ebong from 1995, Sijarbhai is very close to me, and we worked together in the NICVD. I just want to know, actually, a few words from my seniors, any of you into also seizure by anyone. Nowadays, there is a lot of study in this corona crisis. There is a reverse Takotsubo cardiomyopathy. Can you tell regarding this? In this case, the apical region is hyperkinetic and the basal region is hypokinetic in the reverse. Takotsubo cardiomyopathy. Can you tell something, or can you tell a few words? Any of my senior. Thank you.
Thank Already, you. Babu, it was discussed elaborately. There is.
I think I was absent at that time. Absent. Sorry. I'm sorry.
Just for your. There's a. It is a reversible cardiomyopathy. No doubt. It occurs in stress condition. There is now a pandemic era, there is a lot of stress, and usually the old persons due to stress developing the apical ballooning, what is said, there is hypertension.
Yes.
And apical ballooning with syndrome, treatment, right. It become reversible. Okay, thank you. It's discussed previously.
Thank you, CJ. Thank you, Mohsin.
Jalal sir. Thank you, Jalal sir. Again.
Jalal sir, abar unmute korte bolo. Haan, ebar korchi.
Okay. Are you hearing me?
Okay, sir.
Are you hearing? Yes, sir. I thank Dr. Caesar to discuss the cardiomyopathies, cardiomyopathies, not cardiomyopathy, in detail. He has discussed the primary cardiomyopathy as well as secondary cardiomyopathy. He has mentioned many causes of cardiomyopathy. Those causes are known of cardiomyopathy, they are secondary cardiomyopathy. Those who are not known by many investigations, these are the primary cardiomyopathy. So, especially the primary cardiomyopathy, I am very concerned, because in secondary cardiomyopathy, if you treat the primary cause of the cardiomyopathy, primary disease, then the secondary cardiomyopathy may improve. And in especially the primary cardiomyopathy, in which case the cause is not known, in that case, I have a series of primary cardiomyopathy in my practical experience that no cause was found. The age of the patient varies from around 25 to 70 to 70 years old. And in those cases, the primary disease is not known. The patient came with me to with heart failure, and X-ray ECG shows sometimes normal ECG and sometimes some arrhythmia, like, and most commonly the Van der Waals block. More in LVV, some are in with RVV. And I have done coronary angiogram. On most of the cases, the LVV is dilated and hypokinetic. And the ejection fraction usually less than 35 or less than 30. Surprisingly, the coronary arteries, all the coronary arteries are dilated, very big coronary arteries, but with slow flow. I don't know whether we know that the developmentally heart as well as the vessels, peripheral vessels, coronary vessels as well as the peripheral vessels are of the same pattern, so same way like development of the heart. I don't know whether there is any defect in the whole of the cardiovascular system along with the heart, because the coronary arteries are very much dilated and with slow flow in almost all the cases who are primary cardiomyopathy, not known of any of the other disease. We cannot say it is secondary cardiomyopathy. Professor Nozrul has also mentioned very likely that the primary cardiomyopathy and secondary cardiomyopathy. We commonly know the ischemic cardiomyopathy, but this is secondary cardiomyopathy. This is not primary cardiomyopathy. So the another thing we found with primary cardiomyopathy, in whose case I did not find any cause. In those cases, the patients are debilitated depression. And the one thing is common, I found that the hypoalbuminemia, hypoproteinemia with hypoalbuminemia. I don't know why it happens so in most of the cases. And if we treat this patient with albumin, the condition improves, the ejection fraction improves. So it has to be studied more and more further, whether any nutritional factor has got any role in the primary cardiomyopathy. Another thing, that is the peripartum cardiomyopathy. Here also, Professor Nozur also mentioned, and also Dr. Caesar also mentioned that the actual cause, actual mechanism is not known in case of peripartum cardiomyopathy. And peripartum cardiomyopathy, some patients improve abruptly, very quickly, and some patients improve slowly, and some patients does not improve substantially. So, in my practice, I have got one case. The lady, when she was a lecturer of a college, she had first pregnancy, which she came to me with cardiomyopathy. That's a heart failure. I found on echocardiography, it was that it is cardiomyopathy. The later on, the patient with treatment, heart failure, treatment of heart failure. And here also I found hypoproteinemia. The nutritional factors was corrected and the anti-failure treatment was given, ejection.
স্যার আবার মিউট হয়ে গেছে মনে হয়।
আনমিউট স্যার।
ওকে। ওকে, হিয়ারিং?
ইয়েস স্যার।
Yes, okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Okay. That lady asked for another baby. Yes, she had later on had another baby. The first one is the daughter, second one was the son. Still now, the patient was coming to me after 1 or 2 months or 3 months, but she was having normal life, but she was having hypokinetic left ventricle. Later on, she got retired as a principal of Buddhunesa College, that is a government college, and now she is also under treatment. Fortunately, the daughter of that patient became doctor, and she completed FCPS. And now the patient is asking me on treatment on telephone, but most of the time that she is getting the follow-up of treatment by her daughter. So on so long time, she has been suffering from this disease. So one thing is that those cases who are with secondary causes, whose cause is known, they should be, the primary cause of the disease should be treated very carefully. But in those cases, the primary cause of the cardiomyopathy is not known, but the hypokinesia, significant hypokinesia is continuing, they should be treated properly. Especially the nutritional aspect of the treatment should be observed, and nutrition should be given properly.
Thank you, sir.
Take the only part questions. Some of the
Dr. Aptapidin, any question? Just
should not be asked in for this lecture.
You just
should be part.
Dr. Aptapidin,
Assalamu alaikum. Thank you for giving me the floor.
Yeah.
একটা জিনিস জানতে চাচ্ছি, সাবএন্ডোকার্ডিয়াল MI, এটা তো ডিপ ফ্রি ওয়েভ
ইনট্রাকশন। Please ask in English.
Okay.
সাবএন্ডোকার্ডিয়াল MI, there is deep T wave inversion. Yeah. Also in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, there is deep T wave inversion. How to differentiate?
Take the history. Take the history. Always, ECG interpretation should be always be done in the clinical context. And one important thing is, in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, there will be upright in AVR. In subendocardial MI, you don't get it. Very interesting. Oh, yeah.
And another is, there is a with history. With history, nowadays, we have the biomarker.
Yeah.
That is cardiac troponin high. It is highly sensitive. and it can differentiate the either nowadays there is a non-QA ST elevation MI. There is
can be
separated from the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy easily. If troponin I normal, then it is not the.
Dr. Mohsin Hussain, did you comment regarding the this deep QA in the sub-MI and hypertrophic cardiomyopathy? To Mohsin Hussain. Yeah, sound problem.
Sir Mohsin Hussain, would you make a comment about it?
You please open your
adjust your mic, sir.
Please discount your headphone.
Bring your mic close to your mouth.
Can you hear me?
Please bring your mouthpiece in front of the mouth.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Yes, okay, yes. Okay, nice. Okay.
It is sound well now. Yes.
Well, yeah.
In case of that is the subendocardial MI, the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, mostly apical variety, the deep QA inversion, and in case of MI, this is a stent pattern, not deep QA. So in precordial lead, this is the some differentiating point in the by ECG.
Thank you,
Mohsin.
Important question for the students.
Yes.
Hello.
Comments. Yeah.
Two questions in your chat box. One is a giant TOM inversion. Another, the distribution of hypertrophy and hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. I think this is two important subject to discuss. I think partially discussed by Caesar already. So, regarding giant TOM negativity. Actually, we usually call it GTN, not GTN nitrates. So, giant TOM negativity, this was found basically in the Schumann region of the patient, and it was defined as more than 10 millimeter depression, symmetrical depression in the case of that. And most of these patients are having apical hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Actually, in one time, maybe 20, 30 years ago, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy was meaning only for asymmetric septal hypertrophy. So for around 5 to 10 years, this hypertrophic cardiomyopathy was known only by the name of AASH, asymmetric septal hypertrophy, in the older literature. So actually, you can nowadays you can find mostly asymmetric septal hypertrophy, also concentric hypertrophy, also maybe mid-ventricular hypertrophy, by cardiomyopathy, also apical hypertrophy. These are very important because with nowadays in the with the expense of CMR, we can clearly differentiate these morphological types, and these morphological types are sometimes genetically determined. So there are some work is also going on in BSMMU in the genetic lab department of anatomy, where some people are working on it. And also with the distribution of cardiomyopathy, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and the genes involved. Mostly we are like to have MHC gene or also lytrin gene and tinatin gene. So this is two aspects. One is the AACH is not the only criteria for diagnosing hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, but a very important criteria. And giant T negativity or GTN is one of the important aspects of apical hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, which is mainly firstly diagnosed in South Korea and subsequently we found in many of the Saudi countries. In fact, we have our own publication in 1986 or 88 with about 15 to 20% apical hypertrophic cardiomyopathy in our series. Thank you.
Dr. Arif, you hear me? Dr. Arif?
Sir, thank you, sir.
The question in the chat box. Lots of questions.
There is a huge discussion already. Most of the questions already covered. Even then, I am asking a few selective questions. Sir, is there any mortality benefit of ivabradin in case of heart failure?
Yeah.
Ivabradin.
Professor Manojan?
Definitely, ivabradin and all the beta blockers have the mortality benefits in case of the heart failure or cardiac myopathy, that is dilated cardiomyopathy.
Okay. Sir, is there any role of infective endocarditis prophylaxis in case of HOCM?
No.
There is the valve complication that I mentioned. There is infective endocarditis is one of the complication of the hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. There is most of the hypertrophic cardiomyopathic patient having the mitral regurgitation. So prophylaxis of infective endocarditis in some for surgical operation or other things definitely beneficial.
Thank you. Anyone can add something?
Yeah. Professor Bashkar, sir, do you add anything during the role of infective endocarditis, prophylaxis in?
It's the same.
The prophylaxis of infective, the guideline for prophylaxis of infective endocarditis has been changed over years.
Yes.
And nowadays, the things are little bit relaxed. That is what I know. But I wanted to I wanted to have a comment on Professor Babu's question. Reverse Takotsubo. Takotsubo to cardiomyopathy is a syndrome when there is ballooning, that is hypokinetic apex, but hyperkinetic other part of the left ventricle. Right. There are similar thing, but reverse, that is hyperkinetic apex, but the rest of the segment are hypokinetic that occurs in the right ventricle. And classically, we find it in severe pulmonary embolism, but in certain cardiomyopathy, like cardiomyopathy due to systemic sclerosis or sarcoidosis, there we can find hyperkinetic apex. Right ventricle is hypokinetic. Probably that is what known as the first Takotsubo cardiomyopathy.
Thank you,
sir.
Dr. Shohidul Haq, Bogura, do you hear me? Dr. Shohidul Haq, do you hear me? You have a nice, please unmute yourself. Please unmute. You have a nice question I see, saw in the chat box. It is the exam oriented question. I think, what is the prognosis of cardiomyopathy? We ask in the question, the senior teachers always ask the question, what are the prognosis of the cardiomyopathy and different types of cardiomyopathy? What are the prognosis? Sidhar bhai?
In my lectures, I showed the prognosis of the dilated cardiomyopathy.
Different group of cardiomyopathy.
There is a 50% death in 2 years, and prognosis is not good. But in case of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, the prognosis is better. Previously thinking more disaster, but nowadays that is prognosis is 1% in 1 year. That is the prognosis of the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Regarding restrictive cardiomyopathy, exact figure is not known, but the prognosis is not so good because the secondary causes which causes the restrictive cardiomyopathy, that is amyloidosis or sarcoidosis, these are treatment is regarding the treatment of amyloidosis, that is to eliminate the amyloid which deposited in the heart is not possible. Some extra research are going on regarding the amyloidosis, that some drugs can be used, that is anti-cancer drug can be used to eliminate the amyloid from the deposition, or some genetic change which happen if it is reconstructed, then that can be changed. So prognosis of the restrictive cardiomyopathy, exact figure is not known, but not good. The treatment is not so good for the restrictive cardiomyopathy.
Awadu sir, it is the question. You get in the ischemic cardiomyopathy and dilated. Which one is bad prognosis?
It depends upon what is the ejection fraction.
Yeah.
Because ultimately, that's the most important thing. Both ischemic and dilated cardiomyopathy, if the ECG equals complex is wide, LVP morphology, we can go for CRT. But even after CRT implantation, is the DCM that fares better than the ICM. Because in case of ICM, the muscle is already gone. You have much less muscle to work with. And even if you correct the desynchrony, electrical desynchrony, even then it doesn't matter that much. But in case of DCM, if you correct the electrical desynchrony and mechanical desynchrony, it helps the patient a lot better. Of course, DCM is better. Even with RNA, it's the DCM that actually improves better. And that's why we say, even in CRT, the average increase in ejection fraction is only around 5%. But symptomatic improvement is quite good. For some patients, the cardiac function almost become near normal. That's very surprising and very gratifying. One question I have asked the student, yeah. What is the role of 12-chamber pacing and ACM? Sir, bhai.
Yes, the role of the dual chamber pacing, that's the it coordinate the what is the movement, LV ejection is coordinate the LG ejection and decrease the LV pressure gradient. This is the proposed thing, but the benefit is how much it is not established.
Doubtful.
I think he's the pacemaker specialist. What role of dual chamber in ACM?
Mohsin?
Yeah. Please open your headphone, please. Yeah.
Okay. Initially, the dual chamber pacemaker with short AV delay, yes. The force biventricular, that is atrial sense RV pace, it was thought that it improved the output a gradient, that is decrease the gradient. But after that, there is a double blind randomized trial with or without a pacemaker, and there is show there is no benefit of the dual chamber pacemaker in case of patient with with obstruction. So nowadays we cannot advise pacemaker until or unless patient is complete heart block.
Mohsin, can you say
Yeah,
can you say some radio frequency application? Video showed that radio frequency application can be used for the septal ablation. Can you say something about this?
Radio frequency ablation, this is called septal ablation, and two type, one is surgical, is septal myomectomy is better.
No, in your subject, radio frequency ablation.
Radio frequency ablation mainly in the LAD septal branch. Septal territory mainly in the alcohol ablation, alcohol septal ablation. It was done by the interventional cardiologist.
It's not actually that domain, it's our domain.
Part, there is a chance of complete heart block, 8% patient develop complete heart block, and there is chance of sudden death due to MI because during the infarction. So it is done in the lab aid and some case done in the.
I have done that myself.
But the problem is
alcoholic ablation is already done in our hospital also.
Alcohol coil.
But I am asking you regarding the radio frequency ablation.
Actually, that's the domain of the
radio frequency ablation in the ACM.
That's actually the domain of the interventional cardiologist, not EP.
Chitro, okay. Sharma.
Mohsin, very short question. Is there any role or any promising role of multi-site pacing in obstructive varieties of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy?
Sir, multi-site pacing and sir multi-point pacing. This is two different things. Multi-site pacing means it paces from two sites. So there is no clinical data, clinical study that improves this, sir. The outflow gradient in the multi-site pacing, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Dr. Chitranjan Sharma, do you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, you're waiting a lot of time. So, okay, you ask a question.
Yes, sir. Thank you for such a nice presentation, sir. And I have a query. I just want to know that most of the guidelines says we have to wait for 40 days to implant ICD after post-MI. Why the duration of 40 days is kept, and we know most of the cases the death occurs within 40 days or within 2 to 3 days after MI. Why should not early? What is the reason behind keeping 40 days in guidelines?
Dr. Mohsin Hossain, Professor Mohsin Hossain.
After 40 days was applied because after revascularization and hibernating myocardium, increase there is a chance of the LV function. Before that, patient has increased chance of sudden death. So they now the guideline has changed and they advise the wearable implantable cardioverter defibrillator like the jacket. So during this bridging period, within if the patient has sudden cardiac arrest, it can 90 to 99% can patient save the life. After that, if 45 days the patient, the ejection fraction less than 30, then we can implant the transvenous ICD.
It is a chance of improving the option.
Can I add something?
One supplementary just question to Mohsin. Nowadays, the subcutaneous ISD is used in many countries. So do you think that instead of wearable ICD, can subcutaneous ICD can be taken place? I do not know about your experience because I have become an old haggard nowadays. So can you give some new information?
ICD indicated only for the primary prevention of sudden death.
Yeah, primary prevention.
So because when you implant the device, you cannot remove it. So with the audible device, it can breathe, it's like IBP, like something like that. So a breathing procedure. So during this time, after MI to 40 days, you can put the audible ICD. And after 40 days, if the ejection fraction improve, then you can remove the audible ICD. But if you put the subcutaneous ICD, it will be the device will be inserted in the body, sir.
Can I say something?
Yes, sir.
After acute MI, some part of tissue are dead, some are stunned. So we have to give it reasonable time, how much the stunned muscle or hibernating muscle are recovering. And that takes around 6 weeks time. And we have found out, studies have shown, when there is premature implantation of a pacemaker, it may result in harm. A pacemaker actually only prevents sudden cardiac death. It doesn't prevent heart failure. So after MI, you have to give it a reasonable time to find out how much the heart function actually improves. And the ejection fraction is more than 35% or 40%. You don't have to put in a ICD at all. That's the reason. And the studies have shown after 40 days, it's an arbitrary decision, but based on a physiological information. Then after 40 days, we can reasonably put a pacemaker, that will help. Meanwhile, if a patient has high risk, we should use the NTAP picked up, particularly beta blocker, check the LV status and use anti-failure drugs. And if necessary, we can use wearable ICDs, as Professor Mohsin was saying.
Thank you, sir. One of the faculty is here from Malaysia, Dr. Shahjahan Kubit. Would you have some question? Shahjahan, do you hear me? Dr. Shahjahan?
Yeah. So can you hear me, sir?
Yes.
Thank you, Professor Caesar, sir, for your very nice and elaborate presentation. It's a vast subject. I want to know from my honorable panelists two things. Number one is, you see, in the field of hepatology, the end-stage disease is cirrhosis of the liver, or any disease involving the kidney, end-stage renal failure. But in the field of cardiology, my question is what? Is the end-stage heart failure or cardiomyopathy? Number one question. And secondly, the cardiomyopathy involves the muscular layer and also involves the other layers also. So the myocarditis is a sort of inflammation of the myocarditis. Why we are studying myocarditis in the other entity, other topic? Why not is under the headline of cardiomyopathy? Thank you, sir.
Vadu, sir.
The last question, myocarditis in itself is a disease entity. And cardiomyopathy, as Professor Nuzul sir and Caesar bhai already has mentioned quite nicely, it's a collection of a term of different diseases, of different etiologies, of different presentations. So myocarditis, we are rather referring to a particular type of disease, and that should be discussed, of course, in separate hand. And the first question was?
What is the end-stage heart failure or cardiomyopathy?
What is the end stage in the field of cardiology? Heart failure or cardiomyopathy?
Professor Nodosar has given the answer, stage D heart failure. We know that. You have a utilized optimized guideline directed medical treatment. Still, the patient has class 4 heart failure. We call it defective heart failure or whatever it is done. It is end stage.
Cardiac transplantation is last.
Yeah, last is. Oh, one question is there. One question Shomit Portal has asked. Is he here?
Dr.
Shomit Portal from Nepal.
Dr. Arif, any question left?
There is lots of questions. I also want one special question that is related to peripartum cardiomyopathy. What will be the advice once he develops peripartum cardiomyopathy related to pregnancy? Once patient develops peripartum cardiomyopathy, then what will be the advice for the pregnancy in this case? Further pregnancy.
Before answering that, about the definition of end stage heart failure, this is very simple. A simple way to remember is the indication of a patient for cardiac transplantation is the definition of end stage heart failure. That is a simple way to understand and to remember. Regarding peripartal cardiomyopathy, as I have already said, we must follow up this patient after delivery, how she behaves. If she completely cures, every function is totally normal, and no secondary causes has been diagnosed, the patient can be pregnant again, as you have seen an example by Professor Jalal. So this can be done. But important thing is, before you give a green signal for pregnancy, you must try to find very meticulously if there is any secondary cause or not, or if there is any precipitating cause or not. This is number one. If the patient becomes pregnant, the very important aspect is she must be very thoroughly managed in the pre-pregnancy stage and also his pregnancy stage. So with all the prime minister, she will be very closely monitored. And in most of the cases, those who revert back to normal, they can go to almost normal pregnancy. But there are some publication is there. There are certain patients, they also develop peripartal cardiomyopathy even after that. I know one case who had peripartal cardiomyopathy during his last trimester. And she was coming back to normal, but the second pregnancy she passed through his pregnancy normal, and she developed a healthy child. But in the postpartum stage, after 2 weeks, I do not know, she developed cardiomyopathy. But in any case, that cardiomyopathy persisted for a pretty long time, and as far as I know, that he has come back, but his ejection fraction was not above 40%. Was living a almost normal life at least 2 to 3 years before, but I do not know till now. So this is what is my experience. What is about peripartal cardiomyopathy and its recurrence?
Sir, do you hear me, sir?
Yes.
How long you continue drug for peripartal cardiomyopathy?
Actually, I prefer if the patient has resolved and his ejection fraction below 50 or 45, I usually continue two drugs. One is beta blockers, very small doses as tolerated, and AC inhibitors if tolerated. Because these two drugs has got certain antifibrotic and other effects, so that is good. If you ask me other indication, I do not know the indication. From the basic knowledge of other myocarditis and ischemic cardiomyopathy, I usually do it. And anyway, they are doing better. I do not know what for. But this is the usual suggestion.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Regarding, any question left?
Sir, I don't that's close towards the end. So the role of revascularization in case of ICM is a very important topic, I think.
Very important topic. Role of
revascularization. ICM. Ischemic cardiomyopathy.
I think Dr. Mamun Caesar sir is showing a nice flowchart. It is, I think, again, you, Caesar sir, you just.
Professor Nozu sir also mentioned that is after doing angiogram, if it is diagnosed, that is, stenosis is there, it diagnosed ICM cardiomyopathy, then there is MPI, there is viable myocardium should be searched. If viable myocardium is there, then revascularization, either PCI or CABG can be done, and which will be helpful for the patient surviving.
Exactly what he was saying. Exactly.
Can I add something?
Yes, sir.
MPI is available only in Dhaka. So let's consider all over the country what we can do.
But
that's also very subjective. Only few people can actually do it properly, and that also only done only 3 or 4 centers in Dhaka. And elsewhere is very rarely. I can tell you. I see patients all over the country, and I can tell you that. So let's be practical. Number one, have the baseline echo. Start giving guideline-directed treatment. Follow up the patient. If you find out the wall motion abnormality has increased substantially in a wall, that means the hibernating myocardium has been there, stern myocardium has been there, that's improved. That means even then you can go for PCI or CABG, whatever it is, there are viable tissue there that will be benefited. Again, if you get the wall motion hypokinetic, but the wall thickness is preserved, you can rest assured the viable tissue is there. So you can go for, these are surrogate markers. MPI is a rather direct evidence. We can get indirect evidence. If you can use the echo and the findings judiciously and intelligently. But these things can help. LP size is decreasing in size. Erectile phase is increasing substantially. That means the patient has developed the blood supply through collaterals, and by your treatment, it's modified the situation and it has recovered quite nicely. There are some benefit of doing revascularization in those patients. If the wall thick is very thin, in a LAD occlusion, the whole wall is fibrotic, what will be the benefit of putting a bypass graft in there or stenting in there?
This is the along with the echocardiography, also symptom, there is patient history also important. If that the exertional chest pain is there, from my experience, that is very important.
I agree.
Thank you, sir.
Actually, let me tell my practice from very long time. When you think that this patient has cardiomyopathy first, second, try to think that whether this is ischemic cardiomyopathy or not. For example, he has got a history of myocardial infarction, already long-term treatment, and ultimately come to a cardiomyopathic stage. What I usually do is, the seizures first word is, whether the patient is very symptomatic or not, number one. Number two, whether the patient is symptomatic, as on stress or not, or usual activities, say flying stairs, etc. So possibly this may be the patient who has developed cardiomyopathy in ischemic origin, having symptom or signs in stress or like that. So she might have some sort of viable myocardium where the pain, because viable myocardium is the only myocardium which can give rise to pain. No dead fibrotic tissue will have to give pain. Then what I do is, clinically, I assess his physical signs and others, and chest, etc., lung condition, whether condition is there or not, failure is there. After controlling heart failure, what I usually do, I do a simple two-dimensional echocardiogram and try to see what are the context. Means, is the regional territory area can indicate the blood vessel level. If we see some area which is related to our coronary arteries, and that is it is hypokinetic but not a scar, then I usually do a very, very simple test on the echo temp. I have to give some sort of Valsalva maneuver, or try to lift his leg a few times to increase his heart rate. This heart rate increase, if you see on the board and transducer on the chest, if I see the difference between contractility or not, then possibly that is a good indication for that. And from this, if we can correlate the region of coronary artery disease, possibly there is a more chance of his having some sort of coronary artery disease. This can be revascularized. Then if the patient is fit to me for that, and if the economically the patient is right, then I ask the patient whether he can do revascularization or surgery if needed. In that case, possibly you are having a 50% chance that you can improve. If the patient agrees, then I ask directly for the patient for coronary angiography, conventional, and if needed, back. Many patients usually do not like to do conventional angiography. Then I try to persuade them, then can we have CT angiography done? If the CT angiography relates this to two findings, then possibly he is having some viable tissue. And in this case, his advice is they can improve. They can be improved. Their functional capacity can be improved. Symptom can be improved if some sort of revascularization can be done. This is the way I follow usually. This is the follow I usually. I think this is very well explained by a good algorithm by Caesar in his presentation. Thank you very much.
We have the almost we.
Just one minute. It is about the prognosis in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. There are four factors: sudden cardiac death in the family, the thickness of intraventricular septum, the amount of hypotension that occurs during exercise tolerance test, and the tachycardia, ventricular tachycardia that is found in the Holter. These four criteria can help us in finding the prognosis in patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, which is in real day-to-day practice important. That is why I took the floor. My second point is simple echocardiography can at times exclude whether there is viable myocardium or not. Scar tissue, as we know, scar tissue means no viable tissue, but any thickness less than 6 millimeter, you can be sure that there is no viable myocardium. If there is thickness is more than 6 millimeter and you think that there can be viability, then again you have to look at the contractile reserve of that particular segment, because there may be many causes for hypokinesia, including stunning, hibernation, and other things. It is not necessarily if you have got the perfusion in the MPI, you will get back your contractile reserve back. So dobutamine stress echo seems to be, to me, is quite a reasonable and reasonable test and quite a logical test. And I don't find reason why many centers should not have this test. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Very excellent. After excellent presentation by the Professor Manoj Caesar, sir. Nice discussion going on. Thank you, Caesar, sir. Wadu, sir, to ending your program, three comments.
Motion. Motion.
Yes, sir.
Motion.
Yes, sir.
শুনছেন স্যার আচ্ছা আমি একটা একটা জিনিস একটু বলতে যাচ্ছিলাম সেটা হলো যে about not of the subject matter actually can you make it এটা কি আপনি আর একটু কি ইন্টারঅ্যাকটিভ করতে পারেন যেমন ধরেন যে আজকে এই যে জিনিসটা একটা জিনিস খেয়াল করেন যাদের উদ্দেশ্যে আমরা করছি এটা বা করছেন আপনারা সেখানে কিন্তু তাদের পার্টিসিপেশন কিন্তু খুব একটা হচ্ছে না আর বাই ভয়েস তো যেটা করা যেতে পারে সাজেশন আর কি জাস্ট নট দ্যাট ডেটা আপনাকে নিতে হবে সেটা হলো যে আপনারা যখন সাবজেক্টটা সিলেক্ট করলেন তখন কিছু রেসিডেন্ট কিছু ফেলোস ট্রেনিং যারা আছে চারজনকে পাঁচজন আপনারা নিজেরা সিলেক্ট করেন বিকজ ইউ নো দ্যাম এবং তাদেরকে কথা বলতে বলেন তাদেরকে প্রশ্ন ক্রিয়েট করতে বলেন দরকার হলে তারা অন্যদের কাছে প্রশ্ন নিবে নিয়ে ক্রিয়েট করবে অ্যান্ড দে উইল পার্টিসিপেট তাহলে তাদের দুটো জিনিস হবে তাদের এই কমিউনিকেশনটা তৈরি হবে আর এট দ্য সেম টাইম এইসব জায়গা থেকে কি কি প্রশ্ন নিচের লেভেলে ওরা আলোচনা করে কোথায় তাদের আছে এটা হয়তো যেতে পারতো সুতরাং এভাবে ওপেন হয়তো অনেকেই রাজি হয় না বা মুখ খুলতে চায় না যদি এরকম সিলেক্ট করে ফেলেন আপনাদের যারা পরিচিত আছে তাদের রেসিডেন্টদেরকে তাহলে বোধ হয় হতে পারে এটা আমার একটা সাজেশন কিন্তু একটা জাস্ট সাজেশন থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার
থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার আমরা কিন্তু স্যার আমাদের এখানে স্যার আমরা কিন্তু কোশ্চেন কল করার জন্য রেসিডেন্ট থেকে স্যার কিন্তু হ্যান্ড রেজ করি স্যার ওদেরকে কিন্তু আমরা প্যানেলে অ্যাড করে নিই স্যার
Cardiomyopathy is a big chapter, and Professor Mamnoor Rashid Caesar has done a wonderful job of summarizing the relevant information very nicely. Thank you, Caesar bhai. And this has been a very interactive session regarding that from different aspects, different panelists, the students, they have added their opinions, the information, and as Professor Nuthu sir has also suggested, Jay, can he make it a little bit more elaborative or more interactive? We'll try, but all things depend upon what is the subject. Is it 2P or is it smaller so that we can have more time for interaction? Everything considered, I think this format of lecture during the COVID era has actually given us a chance where we, the teachers, have also got the chance of listening to other teachers' lectures. We do not get the chance during normal time. We also are enriching our own knowledge. We also are benefiting, and we also are observing how the other faculties are presenting. And the art of presentation is something that we can always improve upon. We always can learn from others. We do that, and I hope in near future, in future time as well, when the corona is not there, we'll continue this type of educational programs in some form or other. Thank you, Inceptor, for your regular, consistent, and considerable support. And Dr. Mosi, Dr. Shojol, you two are a real warriors. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Sridhar bhai, leave last comments. Just.
থ্যাংক ইউ সবচেয়ে বাংলায় বলি এখন আমার মনে হয় যে মানে এটা আমার কাছে মনে হচ্ছে যে এটা একটা খুবই ভালো প্রোগ্রাম। ওয়াদুদ যে বলছে যে আমরাও অনেক কিছু জানতে পারছি, কারণ এখানে মানে আমি প্রেজেন্টেশন করার পরেও অনেক কিছু নতুন জানলাম, যে মিসকাত ভাই, নজির স্যার সবাই মিলে বা ওয়াদুদ করলো সবাই মিলে। আর যেটা নজির স্যার প্রপোজাল দিয়েছে সেটা ওয়াদুদ কিন্তু চেষ্টা করে, যে যেমন একটা কোশ্চিন করলো যে মানে হাইপারট্রফিক কার্ডিওমায়োপ্যাথিতে এট্রিয়াল ফিব্রিলেশন খারাপ কেন। আমরা এরকম কিছু কিছু কোশ্চেন করতে পারি যেটা যে স্টুডেন্টের পরীক্ষা রিলেটেড, এটা করতে পারি আমরা। থ্যাংক ইউ এগেইন, আই এম রিয়েলি অনার্ড এবং ডিলাইটেড টু পার্টিসিপেট দিস প্রোগ্রাম। থ্যাংক ইউ
ইট ইজ দ্য ইন্টারেক্টিভ প্রোগ্রাম, অ্যাজ নজির সেইড, উই আর দ্য ফ্যাকাল্টিস প্যানেলিস্ট অ্যান্ড অলসো দ্য পার্টিসিপেন্টস, ইজ এ টিম ওয়ার্ক.
Right.
We learn from the faculties, also learn from the participants. Like it is a right. program like that. So
Mohsen,
I think
Mohsen. I mean, যে সিজাবের কথা একটাই বলছি, স্টুডেন্টদের তে কোশ্চেন এর অ্যানসার গুলো পেলে ওরা তো বেনিফিটেড হবেই, ওদের একটা চান্স থাকে যে পরবর্তীতে যে কোশ্চেনটা তারা করলো এখানে যদি অ্যানসারটা নাও পায়, যে কোনো এই যে যারা ছিল তাদের যে কাউকে কোশ্চেনটা করে অ্যানসারটা তারা পাবে, কিন্তু ওদের মেইন বেনিফিটটা হচ্ছে যে জালাল স্যার, নজরুল স্যার, ওয়াদুদ স্যার সহ এই যে মামুনুর রশিদ সিজা সহ এই যে মেশকা স্যার সহ যারা বলছেন, এরা ম্যাক্সিমামই দেখা যাচ্ছে এক্সামিনার হিসাবে ওদের থাকে, তা ওরা কিন্তু এক্সামিনারদের পালসটা বুঝে ফেলছে যে এক্সামিনাররা এই ওয়েতে অ্যান্সার দিলে তাদের জন্য বেনিফিটেড হবে। এটা কিন্তু ওদের, আমার ধারণা, মোর বেনিফিটেড, দে আর মোর বেনিফিটেড যে নজরুল স্যার কিভাবে বলছেন, নজরুল স্যার যদি ওদের এক্সামিনার থাকে ওরা যখন এইভাবে অ্যান্সারটা দিবেন তারই খুশি হবেন। তা আমার মনে হচ্ছে বোথ ওয়েতেই মানে ওরা বেনিফিটেড হচ্ছে, ওদের কোশ্চেন গুলো যদি অ্যানসার দেওয়া যায় এটাও বেনিফিটেড হচ্ছে। তবে এটা ঠিক স্যারের কথা যে ওদেরকে একটু বলতে সুযোগ দিলে ওদের সাহসটা বাড়বে, ওরা আরো বেটারই করবে। থ্যাংক ইউ, সরি আমি ইন্টারাপশন করলাম।
আই থিংক ইট ইজ স্যারের উপর। থ্যাংক ইউ, থ্যাংক ইউ রুদুল স্যার ফর দিস অ্যাডভাইস। আই থিংক আওয়ার নেক্সট প্রোগ্রাম অন 12th জুলাই এগেইন ডক্টর অনিল সাক্সেনা উইথ আস, হি কন্টিনিউ দ্য নেক্সট chapter of the ABC of pacemaker. On 10th, due to our program in the BSCI, we withheld this program on 10th July, but next program in 12th July, only in Saxena. I thank Inceptor Pharmaceuticals, thanks Arif, thank also the panelists. See you again on 12th July, on Sunday at 3 p.m. Till then, goodbye, stay safe. Allah Hafiz.
মসিল, আমি একটা ঘোষণা দিয়ে রাখি, আমার PCT study group এর পক্ষ থেকে কিন্তু প্রতি শুক্রবারে ওই যে সরি প্রতি রোববারে 10টার সময় কিন্তু লেকচার থাকবে, শুধু কার্ডিওলজির জন্য না, প্রতি রোববারে 10টার সময়। শাহজাহান কবির, অলসো ফর ইউ
দ্য টাইমিং ইজ হিয়ার ইজ 12 AM স্যার। আমার আমি লাস্ট আই ওয়াজ প্রেজেন্ট
গুড টাইম ফর
সেকেন্ড ওয়ান, আমি
হাতে ওয়েলকাম তারপরে হোস্টেল ছিল ফর লার্নিং ইসিজি।
Student as well.
Thank you, sir.